Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Paul Laurence Dunbar, The Life and Times of a Caged Bird, by Jean Andrew Jarrett, narrated by Mirron Willis. I know what the caged bird feels, alas, when the sun is bright on the upland slopes, when the wind stirs soft through the springing grass, and the river flows like a stream of glass. When the first bird sings, and the first bud opes, and the faint perfume from its chalice steals. I know what the caged bird feels. I know why the caged bird beats his wing till its blood is red on the cruel bars. For he must fly back to his perch and cling, when he fain would be on the bough a swing. And a pain still throbs in the old, old scars, and they pulse again with a keener sting. I know why he beats his wing. I know why the caged bird sings. Ah, me! When his wing is bruised and his bosom sore, when he beats his bars and he would be free, it is not a carol of joy or glee, but a prayer that he sends from his heart's deep core, but a plea that upward to heaven he flings. I know why the caged bird sings. Paul Laurence Dunbar. Sympathy. Lyrics of the Hearthside. 1899. Introduction. In the October 1914 issue of the AME Review, an author named Alice M. Dunbar, 1875 to 1935, published The Poet and His Song, reflecting on the life and character of her former husband, the legendary African-American poet Paul Laurence Dunbar, 1872 to 1906. When they first corresponded in April 1895, she went by the full name of Alice Ruth Moore. She was 19 years old, he 22. Their epistolary courtship lasted nearly 2 years, until they became engaged in early February 1897. In March 1898, they married, and in January 1902, they separated abruptly, without having children together. Despite his pleas for forgiveness, which she unfailingly ignored, they never reunited. In print and in person, turbulence described the 6 years and 9 months of their relationship, infatuation and love, admiration and encouragement, but also suspicion and frustration, exasperation and fury, as well as intimidation and violence. Even though Alice published The Poet and His Song almost 9 years after Paul's death, she retained the surname Dunbar. In fact, the essay marked her first ever published study of why Paul perceived the world the way he did. So, if one wishes to get a correct idea of any poet whatever, she explains at the outset, he must delve beneath the mere sordid facts of life and its happenings, of so many volumes published in such and such a time, of the influence upon him of this or that author or school of poetry, of the friends who took up his time or gave him inspiration, and above all, one must see what the love of nature has done for the poet. Alice's essay seeks to render more human, if more profound and complex, a person she once loved, but later came to resent during his lifetime, and after his death in 1906, a person she had eventually come to appreciate. The title Poet Laureate of his race, which Paul assumed during the height of his professional career, underestimated the sophistication of his poetry. In lyrical prose, Alice describes the poems Paul wrote that best mirrored his unique literary sensibility. One of these poems was Sympathy, published in his fourth book of poetry, Lyrics of the Hearthside, 1899. The bird's cage, according to Alice, actually referred to the iron grating of the book stacks in the Library of Congress, where the torrid sun poured its rays down into the courtyard of the library and heated the iron grilling of the book stacks until they were like prison bars in more senses than one. Paul worked at the Library of Congress from September 1897 through October 1898. During this period, a series of illnesses cut short his employment there. The dry dust of the dry books rasped sharply in his hot throat, she remembered. What had initially been the proverbial job to die for turned into a job that was killing his body and spirit. Being a poet, shut up in an iron cage with medical works, was ironic incongruity, Alice wrote. Among the stacks, Paul was not a patron, but a prisoner. Now he understood how the bird felt when it beat its wings against its cage. Alice could very well have been overstating the misery surrounding the nature of Paul's job in the Library of Congress. Others who witnessed him there tell a different story, suggesting that the Library of Congress, for all its faults as an oppressive work environment, could never truly suppress Paul's brilliant sense of not only literary time and place, but also how distinctive forms of art, such as music and poetry, could converge, stimulate his imagination, and move audiences. Although its autobiographical basis in Paul's stint at the Library of Congress may be debatable, the poem Sympathy nonetheless testifies in profound existential ways to the miraculous and transcendent bond between the poet and the world. The poem highlights the direct ratio of the poet to sympathy, to the knowledge, as the poem's speaker puts it, of three refrains: what the caged bird feels, why the caged bird beats his wing, and why the caged bird sings. Paul struggled with the belief that he lived and wrote like a bird trapped in a cage, however gilded it might have been by the acclaim of admirers. The poem would reverberate in the century after its publication, its lyrical poignancy and thematic cogency extended in Maya Angelou's I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, 1969. In its depiction of how a young black girl could grow and achieve a personal sense of dignity in the face of rampant racism and sexism, Angelou's autobiography reveals the perennial relevance of Dunbar's original song. A caged bird beating its wings is the story of the individual imprisoned by societal preconceptions and struggling to escape. Describing the life and times of Paul Laurence Dunbar requires that we tell this story. Prodigious and prolific, he was a serious professional writer for a total of 18 years, from 1888 until his death. During this time, he released 14 books of poetry, 4 collections of short stories, and 4 novels, a body of work that showcased his mastery of literary genres: the Western lyric, the romantic poetry of England, the fireside or schoolroom poetry of the United States, the realism and naturalism of American fiction, the racial uplift of African-American literature, and the dialect of informal English. Newspapers and magazines across the country syndicated many of the individual texts in his 18 books of poems and short stories. Across various mainstream and obscure periodicals, he also published essays on the progress, productivity, and challenges of African Americans from the era of slavery to newfound franchise and freedom in the decades after the Civil War. For Paul himself, the achievements of his life and literature, whether accurately or not, served as his benchmarks of racial progress. To wide acclaim, he recited his poems or delivered speeches in private homes, churches, schools, and auditoriums across America's East Coast and Midwest, as well as in England's cities. And he drafted experimental works, including librettos and drama, that exhibited his prodigious artistic versatility. The quality, breadth, and diversity of his literature inspired countless people around the world. A biography of Paul Laurence Dunbar, however, cannot be merely a story of the intellectual ideas that informed the way he wrote literature, nor can it be only an exploration of the mental, emotional, and moral compass by which he oriented himself in the world. It must also recount the wider historical forces that inevitably shaped his personality, the forces that guided the various personal and professional choices that lay before him and that, he believed, would determine the course of his life, career, and legacy. One must tell the full story of an African-American who privately wrestled with the constraints of America in the Gilded Age, but who also sought to express or mitigate this strife through the written and spoken word. Reared during and after Reconstruction, Paul belonged to a generation of African-Americans, of so-called new Negroes, whose parents had been enslaved, and who were adjusting to the capitalist modernity of America. It was a time when the man of letters had to become a man of business, as William Dean Howells, the so-called Dean of American Letters, a renowned critic and writer who had become one of Paul's most influential patrons, acknowledged in 1893. Unless he sells his art, he cannot live. That society will leave him to starve if he does not hit its fancy in a picture or a poem or a statue. And all this is bitterly true. But it also was a time when such an edict leaned on an expectation that African Americans who sought to make a living through literary writing had to tailor it to racial stereotypes. Professional opportunities for such writers were limited to certain types of writing, including the depiction of undereducated dialect or African Americans in the racist mold of blackface minstrelsy. Autobiographical undertones about how Paul himself faced this conundrum can be found in his poem, The Poet, included in his 1903 collection, Lyrics of Love and Laughter. He sang of life, serenely sweet, with now and then a deeper note. From some high peak, nigh yet remote, he voiced the world's absorbing beat. He sang of love when earth was young, and love itself was in his lays. But ah, the world. It turned to praise a jingle in a broken tongue. Paul resented how much the world underappreciated his literary skills and creativity. The facts corroborate his belief. Critics, editors, publishers, patrons, and fellow writers rarely acknowledged publicly, or even privately, Paul's ability to experiment with the various traditions of Western poetry in formal English, from the lyric to the ballad, the rondeau to the sonnet. Beyond the stereotypical language of African-American dialect, he likewise happened to know and write so well. To Alice especially, he complained about how these circumstances so unfairly limited him, about how they forced him to bear a burden of racial authenticity more onerous than what any other African-American writer of his era had to shoulder. Nonetheless, and perhaps ironically, Paul overcame these personal reservations and social conditions to write and recite dialect in ways unprecedented in their artistic excellence and commercial success. To make proper sense of Paul Laurence Dunbar, one has to begin his story well before his birth on June 27, 1872. One must understand the antebellum lives of his parents, Joshua Dunbar and Matilda Murphy, as Kentucky slaves. Their separate experiences during the Civil War, their acculturation to the post-war city of Dayton, Ohio, where Paul was born, and their combustible marriage, violent exchanges, and eventual divorce. As Paul matured, he came to embody contradictions while rebelling against the world's stifling expectations. He tried to be a faithful boyfriend or husband to women, but his wandering eyes betrayed his pleas of fidelity. Alcoholism afflicted his father, and eventually overtook him too, to the horror or fascination of sober onlookers. Paul enjoyed reading, writing, and reciting literature in formal English, but the commercial vogue for the persona and dialect of the so-called old Negro, or of the undereducated, docile slave, pressured him at times to change course to improve the sales of his published literature. Racial politics divided the African-American intelligentsia into partisan camps, either supportive or critical of the industrial ethos of the most famous African-American educator at the turn of the 20th century, Booker T. Washington. As Paul's perspective on racial progress evolved, he would come to support both camps at different times. Under such duress, the conflicted dimensions of Paul's personality became more manifest. He was a temperamental judge of others' failings, yet he himself was insecure. Toward the patrons of the white literati, he was obsequious, yet with the patriarchs of the black intelligentsia, he ingratiated himself. And to multiple women, he wrote private letters that alternately expressed extremes of excessive love and merciless condemnation. The remarkable life and times of Paul Laurence Dunbar break down into three main parts: against the backdrop of the Civil War, Reconstruction, and the rise of Jim Crow segregation. The first section, Broken Home, describes the early lives and eventual challenges of Joshua and Matilda, Paul's parents, the circumstances and consequences of Paul's birth, and his fatal inheritance of Joshua's virtues and vices, his rearing in Dayton, Ohio, where he entered an entrepreneurial newspaper partnership with his high school classmate Orville Wright, who would later be known, along with his brother Wilbur, as a co-inventor of the first airplane that could achieve controlled, sustained, and powered flight, and the years leading to 1893, when he published his first book, Oak and Ivy, and befriended the legendary African-American abolitionist and statesman Frederick Douglass at the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago. Spanning five eventful years, the second section, A True Singer, bookends the era when Paul entered his literary prime and tried to grasp what being a professional African-American writer meant. Literature authored by African-Americans most excited mainstream audiences when it portrayed the stereotypical dialect of slaves, which became the mythical object of white nostalgia once the Emancipation Proclamation liberated 3 million slaves in 1863 and portended the metaphorical disappearance of their racist caricatures and vernacular. This section traces the origin and growth of his infatuation with Alice, leading to their tumultuous courtship and engagement, and it highlights the extent of Paul's personal and professional reach to the era's rising political stars. The final section, The Downward Way, begins in 1898, with his marriage to Alice, the joy of which was tempered over time by episodes of his grave illnesses, his confusing negotiations with editors and publishers, his financial obligations to support his mother, and his erratic behavior worsened by an irrepressible and obscene addiction to liquor. A prominent part of this book involves analyzing Paul's volatile relationship with Alice, whose own comprehensive biography is long overdue, and which accrues more information from the research I have conducted. I plumb his professional networks, which included patrons and politicians on both sides of the so-called color line. White men whom he came to know and admire included the writers James Newton Matthews, James Whitcomb Riley, and William Dean Howells, the medical doctor Henry Archibald Toby, and Theodore Roosevelt, a government official he revered and reached out to, a gesture that this governor of New York and later president of the United States reciprocated. Others in Paul's orbit were legendary African-American intellectuals of his time, including Frederick Douglass and Booker T. Washington above all, and to a lesser degree, the musician Will Marion Cook, the writer James Weldon Johnson, the activist Alexander Crummell, the author Victoria Earle Matthews, and in England, composer Samuel Coleridge Taylor. Paul's countless interactions with editors and publishers, from the renowned Major James Pond and his daughter Edith, to Frank Dodd of the publisher Dodd Mead, reveal how he navigated the perks and pitfalls that accompanied his sudden rise to literary celebrity. In portraying Paul's life, I attend especially to how broad historical forces shaped his personal, public, and professional identities. Newspapers, magazines, and recitals in the United States and during his six-month tour of England in 1897, dictated his tactics and strategies to broaden his literary appeal for commercial gain. Political factors in the post-war stability of American society, including the period of Reconstruction, circa 1865 to 1877, the nomination of William McKinley for president in 1896, and the gubernatorial and then presidential rise of Theodore Roosevelt from 1899 to 1901, played a hand in his access to elite constituencies of readers and sources of political power. The customs of racial taxonomy defined and authenticated his blackness, to be sure, while segregationist policies for public interaction between blacks and whites limited his social mobility and his professional opportunities. And he gravitated to the great minds of literature in the extensive library that he built over time and collected in Loafing Holt, the second floor study in his final Dayton home, where he died on February 9, 1906. Paul Laurence Dunbar was the first African-American born after slavery, that is, the first modern African-American writer, to achieve commercial prosperity and international stature exclusively by his literary works. But he was not just a writer of literature. Although only an occasional librettist and lyricist for musicals, he nevertheless helped achieve two unprecedented milestones in the history of American culture. He wrote the libretto for the first musical with a full African-American cast to appear on Broadway, a one-act show called Clorindy, The Origin of the Cakewalk, which premiered in 1898. And he wrote the lyrics for In the Homie, which debuted in 1902 as the first full-length Broadway musical to be both written and performed by African-Americans. Despite these accomplishments, the blessing and curse of Paul's celebrity status compelled him to behave in extreme or unpredictable ways, ranging from his poised and gentlemanly decorum during his trip to England to the shameful misbehavior in, to repeat Alice's lament, the mere sordid facts of life and its happenings. Like a poem, the essential meaning of Paul's life and literature defies easy paraphrase. Since the late 1960s, academic and public interest in Paul Laurence Dunbar has steadily risen, coinciding with the centennial of his death in 2006 and the sesquicentennial of his birth in 2022. The election of Barack Obama as the first African-American president of the United States likewise inspired scholars of American history to examine precedent circumstances under which African-Americans aspired for high political office and intellectual leadership. Many scholars have gravitated toward Reconstruction, the era lasting roughly from 1865 to 1877, when Dunbar happened to be born and reared and when his early mind matured. During this time, the federal government sought not only to restore to the Union the 11 southern states that allied with the Confederacy during the Civil War, 1861 to 1865, but also to consummate the constitutional franchise of African Americans in the wake of their emancipation from slavery. My biography hinges on the very cultural, political, and ideological implications of Reconstruction for Paul's phenomenal emergence in the late 19th century as a leading writer, intellectual, and spokesperson for his race. During Reconstruction, the so-called radical Republicans employed a vocabulary of higher law that anchored the arguments for African-American franchise to the idealistic Republican principles of the nation's founding almost a century prior during the Revolutionary War. Although not unanimous in strategy or conviction, the radical Republicans objected to the immorality of slavery and its denial of the natural rights of African Americans to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Even though federal emancipation in 1863 undermined slavery, ingrained prejudice after the Civil War perpetuated the constitutional disfranchisement of African Americans. The radical Republicans turned to an obscure provision in the Constitution that assured each state a Republican government. In another sense, the provision granted the federal government and its supporters license to intervene in state practices and enforce the entitlements of citizenship. According to historian Eric Foner, a government that denied any of its citizens equality before the law and did not rest fully on the consent of the governed could not be considered Republican. A host of constitutional amendments established the newfound franchise of African Americans after the Civil War. The 13th Amendment in 1865, which formally ended slavery. The 14th Amendment in 1868, which accorded citizenship to African Americans and certified the rights of citizens to due process and equality before the law. And the 15th Amendment in 1870, which declared the rights of citizens to vote regardless of their race, color, or previous condition of servitude. The Civil Rights Acts of 1866, 1871, and 1875 aimed to add further legal protections and assurances of equal treatment for African Americans. For a time, the core equivalence between Revolutionary-era Republicanism and Reconstruction-era radicalism governed the progress of African Americans in the post-bellum era. Under these post-war circumstances, African American men who served in the Union Army returned to their home states to reunite with family members if they could be found and look for work. However, the notion that the federal government could control the conduct of individual states, particularly those in the South, fueled controversy. As the post-war tool of radical Republicans to enfranchise African Americans and protect their rights as citizens, Reconstruction could not progress unencumbered. Constitutional cornerstones began to crack and buckle beneath the pressure imposed by the more resentful and retrogressive elements of American society, jurisprudence, and politics. For example, in December 1874, the 43rd Congress assembled in the wake of Democratic domination of that year's elections, weakening the grip of Republicans on both the White House and Congress. 10 years would elapse before the Republicans again commanded both branches. For each electoral advantage that Democrats gained, African Americans despaired that the nation took one step closer to the reinstitution of slavery. Slowly but surely, Democrats were reassuming the governmental helm of Southern states. In April 1877, the Southern Democrats conceded that Rutherford B. Hayes, the Republican candidate for president the previous year, could be declared winner over their own candidate, Samuel Tilden, under two conditions. First, Southern and Northern capitalists had to work together to ensure the industrial and economic revitalization of Confederate territories. And second, Hayes had to remove federal troops from Southern state capitals, where they had been sent to supervise contentious gubernatorial and legislative elections. The so-called Compromise of 1877 began to nullify the Republican principles of Reconstruction that ultimately secured the political franchise of African Americans. As one Kansas Republican stated in February of that year, "I think the policy of the new administration will be to conciliate the white men of the South. Carpetbaggers to the rear, and niggers, take care of yourselves." Juridical rollbacks accompanied the electoral compromise. Most notably, in the 1873 Slaughterhouse cases and the 1876 cases United States v. Cruikshank and the United States v. Reese, the Supreme Court weakened federal ability to uphold the liberties and due process of citizens, their right to assembly, and their right to vote, especially when these entitlements, in this court's view, conflicted with the individual jurisdiction and will of the states. Ironically, the very laws that once shielded the lives and franchise of African Americans in the South now exposed them to terrorist violence. Random white mobs and formalized paramilitary organizations like the Ku Klux Klan plundered the homes of African Americans and castrated, raped, and lynched African American men with impunity. Additional laws designed to save citizens from being victims of fraud and corruption seemed inapplicable to African Americans. Political disfranchisement amplified the legal vulnerability of African Americans in post-bellum times. During this period, as historian Nell Irving Painter rightly notes, blacks never held political office in proportion to their numbers, and any black representation at all was a novelty. The electoral relegation of African Americans to the lower congressional chamber, the House of Representatives, as opposed to the upper one, the Senate, starkly attested to this disproportion. For African Americans and their supporters, minimal representation was better than no representation at all. Most whites believed, in contrast, that they would suffer if the political status quo improved or even remained the same for African Americans, as the Reconstruction period of emancipation and enfranchisement faded in national memory. Racist efforts to undo these political attainments grew emboldened and systematic. Eventually, these efforts became victorious in their own right, discouraging African Americans from running for the House of Representatives and relegating them to less prestigious and powerful posts, such as state legislatures and city councils, were tactics espoused by vocal Democratic constituencies and neglected by the deafening silence of Republican acquiescence. By the Compromise of 1877, anti-Reconstruction sentiment in the media had reached a crescendo. Punditry in periodicals and books ranged from the Democratic criticism of government to the broader allegation, condoned by many white conservatives and liberals, Southerners and Northerners alike, that African Americans were fundamentally incapable of representing themselves in the realm of intellect, much less politics. The hallmark egalitarianism of Reconstruction gave way to the purportedly more realistic and practical, but essentially white supremacist doctrine of redemption. Spearheaded by secessionist Democrats and Union Whigs, redemption sought to ensure Reconstruction's utter failure. Historians have shown that racial progress in the 19th century culminated with the Reconstruction-era electoral victories of the first African-American congressmen and judges. Politicians, and less directly, cultural leaders emerged from African-American communities to guide ideological discussions on how electoral politics could combat racial prejudice, injustice, and inequality, and how laws could work on behalf of African-American progress toward complete civil rights. Recent scholarship has enabled the discovery of new archives and literary forms emergent during and in the wake of Reconstruction, such as in association with the African-American writers Charles W. Chestnut, Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, Pauline Hopkins, and Paul Laurence Dunbar himself. The Unfinished Revolution, suggested by Eric Foner in his classic 1989 book, Reconstruction, encourages a historiography that extends the story about the analogous opportunities and challenges of African Americans from the post-bellum 19th century into the 20th and 21st centuries. A comprehensive biography of Paul's life and times enables us to grasp the personal and creative choices he made while maturing into a professional literary writer on the heels of Reconstruction, when he became an emblem of modern African-American letters, but also a key protagonist in the epic story of race relations in America. Only recently have literary experts begun to pursue this wider lens of analysis, revising the long-held premise that his dialect poetry waged merely a masked critique of the white racism invisible to white readers but legible to black audiences. The meaning and consequences of his life and literature turned out to be more complex than that. Writing a biography of a famous American writer, especially in the case of Paul Laurence Dunbar, born of African descent less than a decade from slavery's end, invites a host of challenges. Some difficulties include the process of selecting the most relevant details for biographical inclusion, overcoming the practical limits suffered by the African-American archive during the era and aftermath of slavery, cutting through the myths of his celebrity to the facts of his life, and capturing the essence of his writings, despite how numerous, dispersed, and sensationalized their publications. Perhaps the greatest challenge was documenting only the portion of the literature, life, and legacy of his wife, Alice, that revolved about his experiences, even though recent scholarly interest, including my own, in her historical significance and literary accomplishments continues to grow, and even though she deserves her own independent biography, one comprehensive enough to tell her life story in all its complexity, wonder, and inspiration. I described these largely academic issues in the epilogue to this biography, whose conceptual and methodological puzzles rivaled the various puzzles embodied by Dunbar himself. By the end of this book, new features in Paul's portrait should emerge even for experts in his life and literature. First, he was more concerned and frustrated with the plight and practices of African-American communities than the standard record suggests. Evidence of this sentiment appeared in the editorials he wrote for the Dayton Tatler, the newspaper he edited and circulated for the African-American Dayton community in December 1890. In the frequency with which he wrote poems in formal English, not in the dialect suggestive of African-American vernacular. In his resistance to using African-American protagonists in his early novels. In his and Alice's private rebukes of fellow African-Americans. And in his oscillations between agreement and disagreement with Washington's doctrine of racial uplift. Second, he was more mentally and emotionally unstable than the standard record suggests. Private letters of correspondence between Paul and Rebecca Baldwin tell us that she, a lesser-known girlfriend on the margins of previous biographies, is crucial when attempting to fathom the unpredictable personality and behavior that he would demonstrate later in his more notorious relationship with Alice. His letters to Alice reveal that he expressed suicidal thoughts in regret of having committed violence against her, and throughout his life, he expressed deep disappointment with the course and outcome of his career. Just as the caged bird, as Paul deploys the term in Sympathy, represents a biographical metaphor of the societal constraints on his life and literature, For the Man Who Fails, a poem also appearing in Lyrics of the Hearthside, reveals his inner turmoil. In this poem, the speaker addresses the noble heart and mind of the gallant man who fails. Not only the man who wins the game and earns fame. An intervention of sorts, the closing of the poem imagines a tale of redemption before it is too late, before history casts a fatal glance upon the life and legacy of the gallant man. We sit at life's board with our nerves high strung, and we play for the sake of fame. And our odes are sung, and our banners hung, for the man who wins the game. But I have a song of another kind than breathes in these fame-wrought gales, an ode to the noble heart and mind of the gallant man who fails. The man who is strong to fight his fight, and whose will no front can daunt, if the truth be truth and the right be right, is the man that the ages want. Though he fail and die in grim defeat, yet he has not fled the strife, and the house of earth will seem more sweet for the perfume of his life. Part 1. Broken Home. Beginnings to 1893. Chapter 1. Broken Country. And their deeds shall find a record in the registry of fame. For their blood has cleansed completely every blot of slavery's shame. So all honor and all glory to those noble sons of Ham, the gallant colored soldiers who fought for Uncle Sam. Paul Laurence Dunbar, The Colored Soldiers, Majors and Minors, 1895. Paul Laurence Dunbar was quite bright for a 4-year-old. At this age, he was learning to read and write, a process his mother, Matilda, began before his formal schooling even started. As a child, he used a slate tablet on which he learned the typography, enunciation, and meaning of letters and words. Close to the end of his life, he recalled that his mother watered the seeds of his early literacy. My mother, who had no education except what she picked up herself, and who is generally conceded to be a very unusual woman, taught me to read when I was 4 years old. Matilda could have been deemed unusual for a host of reasons. Her indefatigable will, at the end of the Civil War, to flee her birthplace in Kentucky for a small town in Ohio, all while being a single mother expecting her second child from her first husband. Her temperamental flashes. her hard-nosed protection of her family, her vulnerable acceptance of a troubled and troubling man in Joshua Dunbar, who became her second husband and Paul's father. Equally unusual was her educational resolve, which she shared with Joshua despite the strain in their marriage and the domestic malaise resulting from it. Both my father and herself were fond of books, Paul recalled, and used to read to us as we sat around the fire at night. The semicircle of Paul and his older half-brothers, Robert and William Murphy, created the audience. Matilda's handwritten letters to Paul and her relatives prove that she commanded literacy, which legend says she accumulated over time, letter by letter, word by word, ranging from her access to other school children to her forays in night school. According to Paul, both of his parents valued education. He asserted that his father even played the role of an instructor, despite their domestic hard times. Matilda and Joshua still managed to bring themselves and their sons together to huddle and cherish stories and language as a family trying to grasp what had been penned about their race or their times, about their town or their country, while continuing to understand one another. The stories Paul heard from his mother about the South, about how she survived and left Kentucky, prescribed his vision of the world as long as he lived with her. Here in the evening, around the fireside, an earlier biographer wrote, was an environment of study, of song, cheer, and the lore and romance which had been the background of their forebears. Another wrote that from his father, Paul obtained a deeper sense of the ways of the South, the voices of Joshua, Matilda, and those friends who were former house slaves and field hands from southern plantations, and to whom Matilda introduced Paul, inflected the vernacular wisdom in the old plantation language, regaling him with stories entailing humor and pathos. Looking back, Paul attributed the tenor, the music, the ethos of his poetry about the lives of his parents, about their circle of friends, to his memory of these voices. I have heard so many fireside tales of that simple, jolly, tuneful life. Down in the country districts of Kentucky, I have seen it all. But the journey of his parents, Joshua and Matilda, was far more complicated than merely a simple, jolly, tuneful life. Indeed, the story of Paul's life, of how his characteristic mind and heart evolved from childhood to adulthood and expressed themselves in his personal conduct or literary writings, must begin with the largely untold and difficult story of how his parents survived slavery in Kentucky and, as freed people, built their lives in Ohio, first independently, then together, then apart. Part of this story, particularly that early period about his father, once an artisanal slave in search of freedom, Paul himself recounted for the sake of his family's legacy and embellished on behalf of his literary craft. Joshua was born in Garrett County, Kentucky, sometime between February and June of 1816. Established in 1796 as the state's 25th county in commemoration of James Garrett, its second governor, Garrett thrived as one of the most tillable counties in the state. Joshua's early life there was comparable to those of Africans and their descendants enslaved in the antebellum South. Typically, the slaves acquired their first name in the English language, as opposed to the native language of an African nation-state, from the merchants that sold them or the masters that afterward owned them. They did not devise their own names, as Frederick Douglass and William Wells Brown eventually did. Slaves often retained surnames identified with early owners, states historian Herbert H. Gutman, and they and their descendants carried them from the 18th century into the 19th century from one owner to another, and from the Upper South to the Lower South. As a slave, Joshua was counted as property by the state or federal census, if he was even counted at all. Slavery turned millions of Africans and their New World descendants from human beings into a mere type, according to scholar Ian Balcom. A type of person, or terribly, not even that, a type of non-person, a type of property, a type of commodity, a type of money. If Joshua worked as a field hand, he did not do so for long. He was trained as a plasterer, a member of the rarefied class of skilled laborers that distinguished about one out of every four slaves in the antebellum South. They were not the workers whose toil amid fields of crops and cattle, or whose drudgery within and around their masters' homes was simply manual in nature and menial in stature. Nor were they of the semi-skilled or domestic group of coachmen, gardeners, house servants, and teamsters. Instead, they were the most dignified barrel makers, blacksmiths, carpenters, coopers, harness makers, masons, millers, painters, plasterers, shoemakers, tanners, wagon makers, wheelwrights, the artisans and mechanics who early in life likely first served their owners as apprentices. Masters only reluctantly sold away their apprenticed or artisan slaves. Hiring local white craftsmen tended to be more expensive. Renting the slaves out to owners or businesses enabled masters to skim off the earnings while retaining their property. By the time Joshua was born, plastering was a special skill in America. The last decade of the 18th century had already witnessed the hiring of slaves to help build the District of Columbia's capital. For a little more than the next half century, the slaves were denied the rights and privileges of the government whose buildings they helped construct. Artists and scientists alike, plasterers were attentive to the aesthetics and geometries of artisanship. Peter Nicholson, in his 1831 Mechanic's Companion to Learning Several Professional Kinds of Art, insisted that plastering was useful in the finishing of buildings and furnishes the interior with elegant decorations and conduces both to the health and comfort of the inhabitants. Plastering could be arduous labor. Plasterers mixed and mastered the ingredients of their material. A compound of lime, hair, and sand were boiled down, turning plaster into paste. Slender strips of wood, known as reeds or laths, were latticed across ceilings to support surfaces soon to be plastered. Trowels and hawks carved plaster into globs of paste to be layered and smoothed over and along walls and ceilings. Maneuvered hand, quirk, or derby floats helped lay down the second coat of plaster. Screeds guided the creation of running moldings. The plaster dried and hardened under watchful eyes. The stucco, the ultimate and finest layer, consummated the artistry. Plastering skill made Joshua invaluable to a slave owner. Plastering deepened Joshua's view of slavery. Though his ability to read and write was functional at best, his life likely resembled those of other slaves skilled and lucky enough to leave written records of their lives. Joshua was not unlike a young William Wells Brown of Fayette County, who became the most famous Kentucky-born former slave of the era. He was like an adolescent Henry Bibb of Shelby County, the next most widely read slave from the state. And he resembled Lewis Gerard Clark of Kentucky's Madison County early in life. Skilled slaves were more likely than any other kind not only to desire and imagine freedom, but to strategize ways to achieve it. Such behavior was illegal, but its autonomy and ambition were common traits of slave artisans, as was the intelligence to see the link between labor and wages, to imagine ways of taking advantage of this link, and to develop exit strategies in case their slave owners could not or would not meet their demands as workers. Simply because slave artisans were privileged did not mean that they were satisfied with their lot. Being hired out to other plantations or cities strained their bonds to their families, left them vulnerable to exploitation by new employers, and subjected them to worse conditions of labor. Closer to the end of the 19th century, when he was in his late 20s and in his literary prime, Paul published a short story entitled The Ingrate, set in antebellum Kentucky, and recounting the life of Josh Leckler, a slave hired out as an underpaid plasterer and sharing an abbreviated first name. Both of these details coincided with the qualities of Paul's own father. Josh, according to the story, learns from his master, James Leckler, how to read, write, and cipher, skills that he redeploys to help himself strategically discern whether his contractors are ripping him off. With this learning, Josh repays his master not with obedience, but with deceit, with being an ingrate. He forges a traveling pass in James's hand, flees Kentucky, finds his way through Ohio, reaches Canada as a freeman, and returns to America to enlist as a colored soldier in the Union Army. In a fanciful way, the ingrate enables one to envision Joshua's whereabouts as a slave, fugitive, and free person. Although mostly fiction, the story leans on the actual facts that Paul had gathered over time as a student of African-American history and as a child of former slaves. Artisanship, for example, granted both Josh Leckler and Joshua Dunbar exceptional privilege in their slave communities, resembling the stature of Dave the Potter, a legendary slave who worked in South Carolina in the two decades before the Civil War, and whose mastery of reading and writing, such as by designing ceramic pottery, etching verses on them, signing them, and financially speculating on his artwork, boosted his social authority. Artisanship also granted slaves practical chances to be free. William Wells Brown, upon being hired out at one point in his life, knew that the opportunity of getting to a land of liberty was gone, at least for the time being. Later, around 1840, he knew the moment had come. "During the last night that I served in slavery," he reflected, "I did not close my eyes a single moment. When not thinking of the future, my mind dwelt on the past. The love of a dear mother, a dear sister, and three dear brothers yet living caused me to shed many tears. If I could only have been assured of their being dead, I should have felt satisfied. But I imagined I saw my dear mother in the cotton field, followed by a merciless taskmaster, and no one to speak a consoling word to her. I beheld my dear sister in the hands of a slave driver, and compelled to submit to his cruelty. None but one placed in such a situation can for a moment imagine the intense agony to which these reflections subjected me." Artisan slaves were most likely to occupy the class of managers, rebels, and leaders within their communities. They were also likely to demonstrate ingenuity and persistence in running away, reaching free land, and avoiding capture. The coincidence resulted, in part, from the ability of runaways to act as hired out or self-hired slaves in search of a job, or their ability, while at work, to exploit the time and distance away from their masters that they regularly enjoyed, and then slip away. Artisans took advantage of this skill set and class status within the slave community to escape. Skilled in this respect, Joshua, probably in the early to mid-1840s, or in his mid to late 20s, fled northward when bondage became too much to bear. On October 5, 1845, Willis and Elizabeth Porter Burton, a married couple enslaved on Squire David Glass's farm in Fayette County, Kentucky, gave birth to Matilda Jane Burton around the same time that Joshua, nearly 30 years old, was fleeing northward. She was said to have possessed Cherokee Native American ancestry, potentially inherited from her grandmother, Rebecca Porter. By the time Matilda turned 5, she was one of 15 slaves who lived on the farm, and one of the 11 children under the age of 20. In the course of her life, Matilda came to know, to the extent that she could, 7 siblings, 3 brothers, called Alec, Robert, and Willis, and 4 sisters, named Anne, Ellen, Rebecca, and Priscilla. Matilda's contact with her father, Willis, was superficial. Owned by a different master, Willis dropped by to see his children only periodically, such as Saturday afternoons in the summer. Even so, Few things pleased Matilda more than seeing him these afternoons. Jubilant, she and her siblings would sing and dance. Here comes Pappy, here comes Pappy. Still, Matilda could not connect with him. Even Willis's final reunion with her and her mother, Elizabeth, in Dayton, did not leave a lasting impression. Fleeting was his time in her home, and in the lives of those Matilda was closest to, such as Elizabeth and her grandmother, Rebecca. Matilda and her fellow slaves did not love the farm's owner, Master David. He was an old man, so irritable and hard to get along with, she later remembered. But they loved his son, Thompson, who managed the plantation. Sarah, the mother, also lived there. Around the age of 6, about 4 years younger than slaves typically began regular work as field hands, Matilda was assigned to minor tasks inside the house. Then Thompson fell ill while drinking water in the field and was confined to bed. By his bedside, Matilda tended to him. She used an asparagus branch to shoo flies away. His health continued to decline until he died before her eyes. Afterward, she witnessed the grief of Mrs. Glass, who became hysterical, and of Mr. Glass, his old father, who had been so cross with him. Tragedy in the Glass family had been steady. With earlier deaths of their other children, Marshall at about 12 months in 1827, Sarah Agnes at age 3 in 1834, Joseph at 15 in 1835, James at 31 in 1848, and now Thompson at 28 on August 14th, 1852. Shortly after Thompson died, Mr. and Mrs. Glass, respectively 72 and 65 in 1852, sold their farm, which they could not manage on their own. The sale of the property tore apart the Burton family, and Matilda was forcefully separated from her mother. Matilda moved with Mr. and Mrs. Glass to the farm of Glass relatives Jack and Margaret Venable in Lexington, the seat of Fayette County and one of Kentucky's major cities. Matilda's labor in the homes of the Glasses and the Venables attested to the hardship enslaved girls and women faced in antebellum Kentucky. The home was the locus of the slave girl's obligation to the master's family, which in turn imposed a set of duties that stressed both her lower status and the vulnerability of her own enslaved family. A compact, volatile, and somewhat isolated society, writes historian Jacqueline Jones, the slaveholder's estate represented, in microcosm, a larger drama in which physical force combined with the coercion embedded in the region's political economy to sustain the power of whites over blacks and men over women. Matilda worked to preserve the quality of life of her master's family or of his extended family. She had to tend to the sick, as she previously had done for Thompson, care for any small child, serve the master and mistress individually, along with any relatives residing on the estate, cook the meals, often with dangerously sharp knives, sometimes over open hearths, clean the house and all its recesses, launder clothes in tubs and pots or in the creek outdoors, iron the garments while not getting burned, and hoist loads of them throughout the residence. Domestic work rivaled the strain of field work. Matilda also faced, as many female slaves did, the seasonal move from housework to harvesting. Children her age often were told to act as scarecrows or lug water to field hands. From July or August to December of every year, for about 14 hours per day, she faced the prospect of accompanying the male slaves and handling the plow, the hoe, or the sack of 150 pounds of cotton. And she likely knew that even pregnant women were not absolved of this task. Every one of them was still counted as at least half a hand. They had to do the backbreaking outdoor labor like everyone else. In 1853, after having lived at the Venable home in Lexington for no more than a year, Matilda moved to Louisville, about 80 miles west, to the home of Robert K. White, whom she would later call a son-in-law of deceased Thompson Glass. From here, she was hired out to a number of other homes in Louisville, the first belonging to William and Elizabeth Timewell. When Colonel Wright first took Matilda to Elizabeth Timewell, the elderly lady, who like her husband had been born in England and was then about 70 years old, surveyed the child. "How old is this girl?" Mrs. Timewell asked. "She is 7," Mr. Wright replied. This was the first time Matilda realized her own age. It marked the year to which she would later refer in calculating her birth date, her movements as an adolescent from one master or employer to the next, and her age at any subsequent moment in history. For the next 3 years, Matilda worked mainly for Mrs. Timewell and continued to see her even when she moved on to the service of different masters. On occasion, she took up residence in Mrs. Timewell's home. From about 1854 to 1859, Mr. Wright hired Tilly, as Matilda was also called, to perform a range of odd jobs for other families. She nursed a 2-year-old, shoveled snow, got an employer's relative ready for a wedding. Her jobs varied in location. Some were in Louisville, which was in Jefferson County. Others were in Shelby County, the eastern neighbor. "I had a number of places," Matilda once reflected regarding this time. "Some of the people I worked for were not good to me, but the people who owned me were kind and indulgent and would not compel me to stay at a place if I didn't like it." If at any time an employer was cruel, Matilda would soon inform Mr. Wright, who would return with her the next workday and correct the misconduct. "She is nothing but a child," he would admonish. Joshua chose the most historic, if most perilous, kind of flight. By leaving permanently, he defied not only his master, but also the laws that defined him as property, subject to the discretion of a slave owner. Early Kentucky slave statutes, with the extradition clause of the United States Constitution, established certainly by 1850, the classification and prosecution of slaves as runaways whenever they abandoned plantations for free territories. Urgency fueled his escape. Aside from lashings, both public and private, he likely feared being sold to a state farther south, where flight to free soil would have entailed much longer travel across slave territories. No other free state was more enticing to Joshua and other Kentucky runaways than Ohio, where anti-slavery and abolitionist policies dated back to the time of its admission as the 17th state in the Union in 1803. African descendants constituted merely 1% of the state's total population, congregated mostly in northeastern Wayne County, after they had fled the South and landed among Native Americans. The jurisdiction of Ohio Territory had been adhering to Article 6 of the Northwest Ordinance of 1787, which outlawed slavery in the broader region demarcated by the western and eastern boundaries of the Mississippi River and Pennsylvania, and on the other side, the northern and southern boundaries of Canada's Rim above the Great Lakes and the Ohio River. 15 years later, or the year before Ohio entered the Union, the Constitutional Convention upheld the law establishing a legislative linchpin of anti-slavery and abolition rhetoric for decades to come. Slavery was prohibited in the Northwest Territory. The cultural and political ideals of Ohio complemented the edict. Former white residents of the South, seeking to be rid of slavery, crossed the border of the Ohio River to settle in the state. New England residents, who were far less exposed to slavery than the expatriated Southerners, also formed a substantial part of Ohio's diverse migrant community and imbued the state's community with another facet of largely anti-slavery sentiment. Only a brief period passed after the 1802 constitutional enforcement of Article 6, when slaveholders began to transport their chattel to Ohio and almost repentantly relinquish ownership of the human property. Freed, the slaves held dear the official certificate indicating that they would not become a charge of this county in Ohio as long as they henceforth remained in it. Kentucky slaves gravitated to the Ohio anti-slavery sentiment, societies, statutes, and advocacy for civil rights. In 1841, a personal liberty guarantee for slaves came from the case State v. Farr, in which an abolitionist was charged with abduction and larceny for telling slaves that they were manumitted once they stepped foot in Ohio. Ultimately, the state Supreme Court ruled in favor of Ohio's status as free territory and overturned precedent legal opinion to the contrary. Since then, free African American communities proliferated throughout the state and identified with the fellow free states of the North. Ohio was accessible only after crossing the Ohio River, also called the River of Democracy. Crossing the Ohio River and navigating the adjacent main streets, however, were exceedingly difficult for runaways like Joshua. Most could not swim, and they did not have time to learn how to do so during their journey. Forging the common border between Kentucky on one side and Ohio and Indiana on the other, the treacherous river ranged between 1 and 2 miles wide. Tributaries cut into and out of the river's steep banks, which often rose 400 feet above water level, and in which efflorescent forest trees had taken root. Slaves had to plot how to descend and ascend those banks nimbly and quickly. Joshua and fellow runaways could not ignore the weather's impact on the Ohio River. The Ohio Basin's weather was more temperate than the warmer region west of the Mississippi River and the cooler region east of the Appalachian Mountains. Still, the weather fluctuated enough for slaves to consider flight as a seasonal opportunity, just as merchants and tourists regarded their commercial expeditions on the Ohio River. Extreme cases of sweltering summers and frigid winters made flight nearly impossible. Excess precipitation in the spring months of March through May and the autumn months of September through November threatened to flood the main channel and the tributaries with levels of water so high that the weaker and shorter embankments could not restrain the flow. The river became so choppy that flatboat and steamboat captains refrained from navigating upstream or downstream. In such conditions, the water was so dangerous that tree debris, like planters and sawyers, lay scattered across it. Under these circumstances, runaways had to sneak onto barges, ferries, and steamships as hireable laborers. Some slave catchers counteracted this stealth with their own knowledge about the riskiest ravines, the social exclusivity of vessels, and the sometimes equally mindful officials who ran or worked aboard them or along the waterways full time. Weather dictated the probability of successful flight. Relative to summer and winter, the autumn months provided runaways the best weather conditions to travel long distances by foot. Ironically, the moderate temperatures also facilitated the ability of slave catchers to pursue them. As they accounted for this probability, runaways necessarily resorted to the uncomfortable winter months of December through February. The harsher conditions of cold and snow meant that winter could discomfort, disorient, and discourage slaves and slave catchers alike. The frozen Ohio River inspired slaves to skate across its frozen surface from the Kentucky shoreline, even at the risk of crashing through a fragile section of ice and drowning or dying of hypothermia. Summer was the next most desirable season. From June through August, shrubs were bushiest, tree branches yawned widest with mature leaves, the backwoods sprawled to obscure footpaths. Finally, the spring months of March through May attracted those slaves who, perhaps regrettably, had stayed behind the previous season, in many cases one season too long. Upon exiting Kentucky, Joshua and other runaways trained their eyes not only on Cincinnati, the nearest major city in Ohio, nor only on the smaller stopping points in Ohio associated with the so-called Underground Railroad, such as Moscow, Felicity, Williamsburg, Ripley, Springboro, Xenia, and Mechanicsburg, but also on one or more of the 26 counties located in south-central and southwestern Ohio, where free African Americans settled before the Civil War and returned afterward, including Dayton, the largest city in Montgomery County. In all these cities and counties, slaves knew they could rest and recover on their own before heading to other free states north of Kentucky, like Michigan or Pennsylvania. They knew they could find communities of freed slaves and stay in Ohio until they decided what to do and where to go next. Some runaways turned to another country, like Canada, where Joshua ultimately went. First, he had to cross the Ohio River, dodging the slave catchers who policed the Ohio River, perilously complicated any fugitive's northward pursuit of free soil. He likely tried to reach one of the major crossing points in Kentucky, cities situated as close as a quarter mile to as far as 5 miles from the river banks. Joshua likely trudged 15 miles per night by foot, sometimes farther, depending on preparation, health, desperation, and luck. Trekking runaways were wise to choose the relatively quiet weekends over the weekday traffic. They paid attention to when and where the Ohio River, during a cold season, froze solid enough to traverse. For the decade and a half after 1850, many slaves turned to the Underground Railroad of former slaves and Quakers. Joshua settled in the Ohio town of Troy, about 20 miles north of Dayton. From the 1820s onward, Troy was a hub of citizens and commerce. The Erie Canal connected the Hudson River to Lake Erie. The Ohio Canal linked the Ohio River to the lake. And the Miami Canal, beginning in Cincinnati, about 50 miles south of Dayton, went through Dayton and by way of Troy. As canal towns, Dayton and Troy abounded with flour, textile, and sawmills, and enjoyed modern transportation. Starting in 1837, the din of Miami Canal boats was Troy's industrial soundtrack. About a decade and a half later, in March 1853, the first train, an outcome of the boom in railroad construction, disembarked in Troy. The 15 months of railroad construction now joined Cincinnati, Dayton, and Troy. 2 years after the first boat traversed the Miami Canal, African-American families had begun to settle in the west end of Troy and established the St. James Methodist Episcopal Church. While African-Americans congregated in their own geographical sanctuaries, the larger Troy community of Methodists, which comprised abolitionists, grew divided over the moral problem of slavery in the early 1840s. As the Civil War approached, ministers praised the Union while denouncing the secessionist slaveholding states, and they urged the congregants to help defeat the Confederate Army any way they could. Troy was hospitable to African Americans precisely because most townspeople were Republican abolitionists. Even before its rise as a canal and railroad town, Troy was essentially a stop on the Underground Railroad. For Joshua and other slaves fleeing Kentucky, the paths via Dayton to Troy, then to Canada, were logical. By the time the abolitionist cries amplified in the 1840s, slaves were already exploiting the Miami Canal boats in which they could lay low in the secret cargo holds and await disembarkation at Troy, where they might rest, recover, and find work in a nearby place to live, or where they could proceed on their course, as Joshua had, toward Canada. Joshua's path to freedom recalls those of other Kentucky slaves who cut through Ohio and settled in Canada. Since the early decades of the 19th century, Canada was one of the lands of opportunity and equality for which runaways, especially those coming from the Upper South, longed. But the region was difficult to reach. Only the most clever, motivated, and yes, fortunate slaves stepped onto Canadian soil with the energy and motivation to start their lives anew. And because they could stop their flight short of the Canadian border and find a degree of freedom, writes historian Robin W. Winks, to continue to British territory was an act of conscious choice, in part a positive decision rather than a negative impulse arising from fear, as it would become after 1850, when the U.S. Congress passed the Fugitive Slave Act, as the part of the compromise between the southern and northern states, mandating that law enforcement officials or marshals across the country had to apprehend anyone suspected of being a fugitive slave. As one of the slaves determined to travel and settle in Canada, probably in nearby Ontario, at that time Canada's most populous province and one of its largest in square miles, Joshua faced the practical questions of how to get to this promised land, and what to do once he got there. Which Ohio crossing points of the Underground Railroad were most secure? The cities of Toledo and Cleveland, or the lesser-known Sandusky, Huron, Lorain, Sheffield Village, Ashtabula, and Conneaut, By float or ferry was Lake Erie as troubling to cross as the Ohio River? And which Ontario border town was safest, the outermost Fort Malden, or the inland towns of Amherstburg, Sandwich, and Windsor, only about 5 miles from Detroit, Michigan? Or those towns running along the Thames River, parallel to Lake Erie's shoreline, such as Elgin, Chatham, Don, and Longwood? Further questions abounded. How worthwhile was navigating the recesses of Ontario if doing so demanded a lot of money and equipment? If it detracted from an ability to return to America on short notice? If it led to landscapes and villages uncomfortably foreign? Or if it led to places where no other runaways could be found, or where no one looked like him? In the mid to late 1840s, Joshua found his way to Canada. Free African Americans had already blazed the trail there. Large contingents of slaves had already fled antebellum Ohio, rejecting its enforcement of the black laws or black codes, which denied mulatto or black persons residence in that state without an authentic certificate of manumission if formerly a slave, without an official attestation of actual freedom if not an ex-slave, or without the registration of family members at a courthouse. The codes were not repealed until 1849. Some runaways sought the more hospitable environs in neighboring northern states, Indiana or Michigan to the west, and Pennsylvania to the east. Others corresponded with Sir John Coburn, a lieutenant governor of Upper Canada, asking permission to relocate there. Usually he agreed, alluding to their entitlement to all the privileges of the rest of His Majesty's subjects. In the 2 decades leading up to America's Civil War, acres of land were allocated to the Cincinnati settlers intermittently, their exodus speeding up or slowing down according to whether their treatment in Ohio was worsening or improving. In the 1840s and 1850s, runaways settled near or within exiled communities located in cities like Colchester, Amherstburg, Windsor, London, Chatham, and Dresden. The neighborhoods tended to be homogeneous and segregated from white Canadians. Informal separation of black and white students in schools slowly crystallized into law. The goodwill white residents initially showed African-American settlers gave way to feelings of resentment. The local government felt pressured to stem the tide of immigration. Once again, the settlers from Ohio had to deal with discrimination, even as they took solace in having fled its more profane and deadly manifestations on native soil. Work opportunities greeted Joshua by the time he arrived in Ontario. While most Kentucky runaways had to work as farmhands upon their arrival in Canada, skilled laborers could expect to find better jobs if they were willing, as the settled African-American immigrant communities already were, to abide by the provincial laws of a foreign land. The runaway slaves also could serve in the Canadian military, where settlers or citizens of African descent had been stationed as far back as 1793 at Kent, 1807 at Fort Malden, and 1812 at the Niagara border, and 1837 during Upper Canada's own rebellion. To be sure, their actual service was devoid of romance. They took up the mundane tasks of guarding bridges and buildings, patrolling canals, clearing roads, of volunteering in ways that would not be impeded by their overall lack of education or literacy. Throughout the rest of the 19th century, they were more likely to be celebrated as military heroes or veterans in Canada than their fellow runaways were after fighting for the Union in the Civil War. For runaways living and finding work in Canada, the allure of returning to family, friends, and familiar American surroundings was difficult to overcome. Nor could the runaways help but view themselves ambivalently, betwixt and between old and new worlds. The enslaved descendants of Africa had every reason to flee northward, yet British protectionism had far fewer but still justifiable reasons to accommodate them. One question was unclear, however. Would Canada welcome the fugitive immigrants to the country and ensure them proper claim to all the rights and privileges of Canadian citizens or long-time residents? strains inevitably afflicted any bond that formed between the fugitive settlers and the African and indigenous natives of Canada already struggling to assert and enjoy their own civic rights. Certain slaveholding jurisdictions in America began to request diplomatic assistance from the Canadian government to extradite runaways and return them to their rightful owners. Within a decade after the initial panic of the fugitive slave law in 1850, Canada's influx of runaways had subsided to a crawl. By this time, the Civil War was about to begin. Runaways living in Amherstburg and elsewhere in Canada were trying to decide when was the best time to return to their house, divided, and fight in the Civil War. The Confederate attack on a Union base at Fort Sumter, South Carolina, on April 12, 1861, forever altered the lives of Joshua and Matilda, just as it had the lives of all African Americans seeking to survive the era of slavery. Also called the War of the Rebellion, the Civil War extended the long-standing American conflict between the North and the South. Having African or African-American men, women, and children in bondage was crucial to the South's quality of life, its economic prosperity, and its hierarchy of the races, whereby the Anglo-Saxon immigrants and descendants of Europe could allege and affirm their own superiority. The South perceived that the federal government, under the presidency of Abraham Lincoln, was guilty of the oppression of the Southern slaveholding states. Unless actively counteracted, the oppression would upend the Southern order. The Southern states' rebellious plan to secede from the Union triggered the war that would last 4 years. For a slave like Matilda and a runaway like Joshua, the Civil War pivoted on the practical and moral question of slavery. Slavery would have been upheld in perpetuity if the Confederate Army had won. Overturning it would require not only victory by the North's Union Army, but also the federal government's ability to reconstruct the South, preparing it for life afterward. New World Africans were already accustomed to getting involved in America's military conflicts, such as the Revolutionary War and the War of 1812. The Civil War's political meaning hit closer to home. When Matilda, at the age of 15 or 16, married another slave, Wilson Murphy, at Marse Jack Venable's Lexington estate, their time together lasted barely a year, since he would leave to enlist in the Union Army as soon as African Americans were permitted to in 1862. Indeed, only with its back against the wall, staring at defeat, did the Union Army allow the enlistment of African Americans, whether slaves or fugitives, freed or born free, given that carrying out the new policy exacerbated entrenched racist attitudes and practices. Short-term policies were already in place in the war's early months, by which the federal administration and Union Army officials demonstrated an eerie compliance with Southern slaveholding ideology. During the arrival of the Union Army in Confederate territory, for example, if slave uprisings happened to explode in their midst, Union soldiers would consider helping to quell them. The Union Army's initial aversion to helping slaves accorded with its early reluctance to recruit them. Tightened during the antebellum era, wartime policies denying the military enlistment of African Americans were reaffirmed by Secretary of War Simon Cameron. Over time, such icy treatment of African Americans continued to thaw. The increasing military and social tensions between Southerners and Northerners seeped into the Union ranks enough to discourage compliance with slaveholders. A host of military actions and federal decrees paved the way toward allowing African Americans to enlist, albeit only in racially segregated regiments. The First Confiscation Act, passed in August 1861, denied a slaveholder ownership of those slaves permitted to assist the Confederate Army. Almost a year later, in July 1862, the Second Confiscation Act more explicitly manumitted slaves during the course of the Union Army's military seizure of property, which may have included these very slaves, belonging to supporters of the Confederacy. The Militia Act of 1862 was, to date, the most forthright expression of the Union Army's willingness to permit persons of African descent to enter the service of the United States for the purpose of constructing entrenchments or performing camp service, that is to say, any military or naval service for which they may be found competent. Finally, President Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1, 1863, formally freeing all the slaves in southern states and decreeing that these slaves would be received into the armed services of the United States to garrison forts. Wilson Murphy thereby became one of the 93,000 African-American men enslaved in the Confederate States who went on to enlist in the Union Army. The mothers, wives, and daughters of these men, not to mention the slaveholding families for whom they continued to work, all buckled beneath wartime's duress. Masters and mistresses grew anxious over the fate of the privilege and entitlement of their livelihoods. Women slaves grew even more fretful over the fate of their own families. Short-term responsibilities to those who could not care for themselves, small children or the elderly, preoccupied women slaves as much as, if not more than, the long-term prospects of freedom that Washington, D.C. anticipated if the Union Army conquered the rebellion. Former slaves, like Joshua, sought to join the Union Army for their own sake or, like Matilda, were left behind to tend to families and wonder what fate had in store for them when the war came to an end. Slaveholders witnessed the deterioration of their way of life, the demise of an old South whose very reliance on slavery for custom and commerce the Confederate Army fought desperately to preserve. The death of over a quarter of a million soldiers stood as one measure of that decline. The Civil War also galvanized Northerners. Their collective goal was military victory over the South, not the abolition of slavery, but the federal emancipation of slaves in Southern territories implied a deep-seated connection and circularity between the two. The Emancipation Proclamation of 1863 authorized the full-scale enlistment of African Americans in the service of the Union Army. With the proclamation in effect, Joshua could depart Canada without fear of recrimination. Newfound humanity and citizenship were possible. He was one of about 200,000 African Americans out of a total of 100,000 free blacks, plus 800,000 slaves available, constituting the 163 units of the Union Army. He set his sights on Reedville, Massachusetts, where he could enlist and muster into service. Remarkably flat, prone to spring mud, dreadful in the winter, Reedville was known as Dedham Low Plain. About 10 miles south of Boston, along the eastern side of the Boston and Providence Railroad, before it was renamed in honor of James Reed, circa 1850. 15 years later, by the time the cherished cotton mill owner died, Reedville became the site of Camp Meigs, a complex of about 125 acres on which stood soldier barracks, a cookhouse, company headquarters, a hospital, a pest house for the ill, a mortuary, a prison, a chapel, a store run by a sutler, or a man who orbited the soldiers and sold them supplies, ranging from merchandise to food, storehouses, and by the war's end, a stable for horses. John Albion Andrew, Republican governor of Massachusetts, first erected these facilities for the most important corps to be organized during the whole war, the 54th Regiment of Massachusetts Volunteer Infantry. The 54th Massachusetts exerted such a gravitational pull that aspiring African-American soldiers in the North found it irresistible. Despite early skepticism, they flocked to it, acting upon the words of anti-slavery leader Frederick Douglass, encouraging them to join. A local periodical like the Anglo-African likewise exhorted them to prove themselves as men. Along with their wives or women in their communities, African-American soldiers or interested onlookers donated funds to buy an American flag or facilitated recruitment to raise a regiment in the 54th Massachusetts. Just as Joshua was being drawn to this infantry, Reedville, instead of Canada, was becoming the final stop for the Underground Railroad. The rates of enlistment and publicity for the 54th Massachusetts soared, as did, however, the swirling of epithets like colored children at Camp Africa, in the mouths of cynical observers near and far. On June 2, 1863, Joshua formally enlisted in the Union Army. Unfortunately, the 54th Massachusetts had just closed its doors to further recruits about 1 month earlier, on May 11th. At camps like Reedville, 100 men enlisting in one region formed a company, and 10 companies formed a regiment, several of which made a brigade, several of these a division, a handful of divisions a corps, and multiple corps the whole Union Army. The actions of regiments within one brigade complemented one another. Part of a bigger web of military interconnections, the 54th Massachusetts was capped in size and function, even as it was fabled as the first unit of African-American soldiers raised in the North. In fact, its very attractiveness caused it to burst at the seams. Officers and privates were transferred from the 54th Massachusetts to accompany the surplus of recruits to the old Reedville camp of the 2nd Massachusetts Cavalry, where they set up base on May 12th for the 55th Regiment of Massachusetts Colored Infantry. Enlisting for a term of 3 years, Joshua became one of the 99 men to serve in Company F of the 55th Massachusetts. Records say he was 40 years old upon enlistment, but he was more likely closer to 50. Certainly not a typical private. The regiment's soldiers were in their early 20s, on average. At 5 feet 10 inches, he stood about 2 inches taller than the average fellow soldier. The word dark was scrawled in the enlistment ledger to describe his eyes and complexion. He was in need of new clothing. He declared that he had become free a little more than 2 years earlier, on or before April 19, 1861, which happened to be 1 week after the attack on Fort Sumter. He was part of a distinct numerical minority of 55th Massachusetts enlistees who were former slaves. Just as he was the peculiar soldier, Joshua was the peculiar ex-slave. Unlike the great majority of soldiers who formerly called themselves farmers, he was one of the few who had mastered an artisanal skill as specialized as plastering, and he listed it as his occupation. If Joshua did share a trait with his comrades, it was that he claimed Troy was his current residence. He stood in a long line of fellow 55th Massachusetts soldiers who claimed Ohio more than any other state as either their birthplace or their home. In Company F, 4 hailed from Troy, 24 from Ohio alone. Matilda spent the time while Wilson was in battle working for different masters and mistresses between Fayette, Shelby, and Jefferson counties, alternately working and returning to Mr. and Mrs. White's Louisville home. Her uncertainty over whether Wilson would return was resolved in the spring of 1863, when she once again came face to face with her husband of 3 years, 2 of which he had spent serving in the Union Army. Approaching her 18th birthday in October of that year, Matilda and her husband had some catching up to do. Months earlier, on New Year's Day, Lincoln's executive military order emancipating slaves residing in the Confederate States had officially gone into effect. The decree took a little while to roll out across the South. The event was more than a relief. If freedom hadn't come, Matilda once remarked, I'd been killed. Matilda heard first through hearsay from fellow slaves that they were free. The slaveholders confirmed it. Filled with elation and ecstasy when she realized the news one early morning, she jumped up and down from the loft with a whoop and a holler, singing hallelujahs as bold as a mockingbird. However, the persistence of Matilda's joy was put to the test by Wilson's arrival. Both got off to a rocky start. Though husband and wife, they hardly knew each other. Prior to Wilson's departure a couple of years earlier, Matilda recalled a formative strain in their trust that was still having an impact. Before I was emancipated, he gave me a watch, Matilda remembered. Working with it all the time, I broke the hands. And he took it and said he would have it fixed. But I never got it back. He said somebody stole it. When he came back from the army, he had another watch. A great, big, heavy man's watch. I saw a guard string around his neck, and I jerked it out right quick. And there was a watch. Then they had a tempestuous exchange, attesting to the marriage's fragility. "That's my watch," Matilda insisted. "How's that?" Wilson questioned. "You took mine. So this one's mine now." He took the guard off and handed it to me, Matilda later said. When he didn't get work and I didn't have support, I told him that I was going to sell the watch and take the money and go to my mother's, which I did. Matilda sold the watch for $14. The cash helped hold her over while she tried to make ends meet in a Confederate state whose economy was reeling from the war. The money also represented her independence from Wilson, whose detachment from the marriage and whose employment woes denied him the status of breadwinner. Matilda fretted that since Wilson didn't do his duty financially, the instability of their family resulted as much from the tension between husband and wife as from the unsettling rebellion and its economic consequences. Life would not get any easier for Matilda. After emancipation, she had rejected the money her mother Elizabeth had sent down to her while she was staying in Mrs. White's Louisville home. She was supposed to spend that money to make her way toward reuniting with her mother and grandmother Rebecca in Dayton, but Matilda preferred to stay at Mrs. Timewell's. She wanted Wilson to return from the army, regardless of the problems they had prior to his departure. The choice proved fateful. Within 1 year of Wilson's return in Shelbyville, Matilda, aged 19, gave birth to their first child, William Travis Murphy, on February 12, 1864. The date also happened to be Lincoln's birthday. Far more than their free white contemporaries, women slaves like Matilda tended to suffer high rates of miscarriage, infant mortality, and fatal illness. Masters expected their slaves to procreate to enhance their financial capital or fill the ranks of laborers, even as they imposed backbreaking work on their women slaves, who were already weary in the months leading up to and in the wake of childbirth. Matilda and her son, William, were fortunate to have survived these conditions. Mrs. Timewell dedicated valuable time to William's care, even though she was still recovering from the death of her own husband, also named William, an England-born cabinet maker who died of dropsy. The ailment, which had led to his sharp 2-month decline in health and his death in June 1860, would afflict Matilda's own child a decade and a half later. Mrs. Timewell dutifully nursed Buddy, the nickname for Matilda's baby boy. "I would go in," Matilda recalled decades later, "and she would be setting the rocking chair. Maybe he would be asleep in her lap, or maybe she would be asleep, and he'd be standing by, holding on to her." Ever grateful, Matilda was never reluctant to heap praise onto one of her most generous mistresses. God bless her. God bless her. 3 weeks following Joshua's enlistment, the 55th Massachusetts was mustered into service. Joshua's uniform comprised an overcoat, dress coat, pants, a pair of jackets, a cap with visor, and shoes, along with a haversack containing his bayonet, blanket, and cooking and eating supplies. He was prepared for the long journey ahead of him. On July 21, 1863, Company F, along with companies A, B, C, D, E, G, H, I, and K in the 55th Massachusetts, left Boston on the steamer Cahaba, set for Morehead City, North Carolina. Nearly a week later, they landed in Morehead City. By rail, they proceeded to New Bern and then set up camp on a riverbank near Fort Spinola. Another 4 days passed. They marched out of North Carolina and toward Charleston, South Carolina, where they hopped aboard the steamer Maple Leaf. On August 3rd, Maple Leaf landed on Stono Inlet, off Folly Island. The men made their way along the beach toward the island's north end, bivouacking in the sand. The 2-week trip from Boston to Folly Island by foot, rail, and boat covered about 1,000 miles. From their arrival on August 3rd, about 400 soldiers had to do continuous fatigue duty each day on Morris Island, a nearby territory in South Carolina, for the rest of the month. Their tasks, as Major Charles Bernard Fox of the 55th Massachusetts wrote, included cutting timber, making gabions, that is, wirework containers for constructing retaining walls, building wharves, loading and unloading stores, artillery, and ammunition, hauling heavy guns to the front, and working in the trenches on Morris Island. The greater part of the work was under fire. Only in September, after the soldiers in the regiment had spent enough time together to improve their military discipline, did the tasks begin to lighten up. When Joshua and the rest of the 55th Massachusetts arrived on Folly Island, they were introduced to Mrs. Shovel and Spade, in the words of James Henry Gooding, a 54th Massachusetts corporal. Weakening, the men indeed were struggling to adjust to the warmer southern climate. The men had to travel almost everywhere by foot, their leg pain, the inevitable price of fatigue duty. Fatigue duty was endemic to the African-American regiments of the Union Army. It was non-combat work and the least appealing. In principle, it recalled the drudgery of slavery, and in practice, it kept African-American soldiers away from the battlefield. "The spade and the shovel is their only implement of warfare," wrote one Civil War chronicler in regard to the 54th Massachusetts. In his view, these troops were in a state of demoralization. Fatigue duty, as heavy as the kind Joshua faced on Morris Island, tended to exhaust, debilitate, and even kill African-American soldiers, whose morbidity and mortality rates were higher than those of any other defined group in the Union Army. On August 24, 1863, Joshua was declared unfit for duty on account of injuries received by lifting while on fatigue duty. He was marked present on the muster rolls of September and October, but on October 23rd, he received his certificate of disability of discharge, filled out by a surgeon at the Folly Island Medical Headquarters. During the 60 days prior, the surgeon wrote, Joshua had been unable to work as a consequence of the varicose veins of the left leg, which he has been liable for 18 years, and which have prevented his doing duty during the past 6 weeks. Fatigue duty ended Joshua's career as a Civil War soldier. It had inflamed the varicose veins that had likely developed in the mid-1840s during his long flight, largely on foot, toward freedom, and it relegated him to a rare group, the 10% or so of 55th Massachusetts soldiers, whose disability on account either of sickness or of wounds received, in action or by accident, led to their discharge. As far back as the preparation in Reedville, the African-American regiments of Massachusetts were at higher risk for sickness and death than white soldiers, North and South, even before they went into battle. Joshua had served honestly and faithfully, according to the certificate of discharge. Aside from serving his country, he received no benefits from his stint in the 55th Massachusetts. He was a private, who lacked either the time or the ability to ascend in rank. Upon discharge, he had not yet received any compensation, such as the bounty of $50 he was due for his service after his enrollment in Reedville. Withheld or erratically dispersed bounties for African-American soldiers, that is, the sums the state promised to pay them upon their enlistment, were the subject of protests in the 54th and 55th Massachusetts infantries, and when they were paid, it was consistently and unfairly less than what their fellow white Union soldiers earned. Service records show that upon discharge, Joshua was still entitled to pay and subsistence for traveling to place of enrollment, to the tune of $39 for clothing. But he still owed $2 to D.W. Johnson, a sutler, or company, as Johnson called himself. In August 1863, Johnson had propitiously pitched his tent at the 55th Massachusetts campsite and sold provisions to the soldiers. The soldiers were running out of supplies, and Johnson sold other valuable items ranging from literature and food to tobacco and alcohol. Excessive drinking was common among Union soldiers, including the 55th Massachusetts. Alcoholism would plague Joshua in the years after his service, well into his marriage and parenthood, and near the time of his death. Once again, Joshua was in Massachusetts. In the opening weeks of 1864, despite his disability diagnosis, he sought to rejoin his fellow African-American soldiers in the fight against the Confederate Army, against slavery. He knew that Massachusetts was the hub of recruitment for colored soldiers. On Long Island, the one located in Boston Harbor, resided a number of draftees into the 54th and the 55th Massachusetts Infantries. In January 1864, recruits were being sent down to the 55th Massachusetts in South Carolina, just before the infantry moved on the following month to decamp in Florida. Some recruits not yet sent southward, backlogged in the Long Island camp for drafted men, were eager to serve a new regiment being raised in the state, the 5th Regiment of Massachusetts Cavalry Volunteers, whose headquarters were located nearby at 21 School Street. On January 9th, Joshua traveled to Ward 6 in Boston's North End and enlisted in the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry. He was then sent about 10 miles south, back to the more familiar grounds of Reedville. Merely 7 months after he had gone there to enroll in the 55th Massachusetts, he was back, awaiting further instructions on the nature of the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry's involvement in the War of the Rebellion. On November 28, 1863, the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry welcomed its first volunteer to Company A. Cavalry companies, each ranging between 60 and 78 troops, filled up at a steady pace. The 1st Battalion, including Companies A, B, C, and D, reached its limit by February's first week. The 2nd Battalion, comprising Companies E through H, was ready after about 40 days, by mid-March. The 3rd Battalion, Companies I through M, after a little over 54 days, by early May. Within 6 months, the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry, which ended up having about 1,200 men, was fully staffed. Joshua was welcomed to a 3-year term in Company F. His age was now listed as 42, although 2 years had not yet passed since his first enlistment. He was now 1¾ inches shorter than before. His eyes were dark, his complexion cold, more likely an abbreviation for colored, the handwriting left out the apostrophe. Then a description of his temperament. Yet his birthplace, again misspelled as Garrett rather than Garrod, hair black, occupation plasterer, and rank private went unchanged. Also relatively unchanged was Reedville, whose muddy flatlands provided little resistance against the freezing winds that whipped across the state in the first weeks of 1864, which only worsened the winter discomfort in which he and his comrades writhed. Matilda's husband turned out to be nowhere near as involved as Mrs. Timewell was in raising newborn William. In fact, Wilson decided in either late 1864 or early 1865 to re-enlist in the Union Army. He promised to reunite with Matilda if she held true to her plan of leaving Kentucky for Dayton, Ohio, where her mother and grandmother lived. In the meantime, the pull of the Civil War was irresistible. Willis said it was his war, and he had to get in it, Matilda remembered. He said if he was to live through the fighting and all, he'd go to Dayton, and I must go there and find my mammy and wait for him. Well, I couldn't go right away because Buddy was just a baby. Wilson likely left in late 1865 as the war was ending. The Union Army no longer needed his services or the services of other former African-American slaves as it had at the war's outset when it was incurring innumerable casualties. As her husband's image and import faded, Matilda had two goals: keeping her toddling son and unborn child safe and healthy, and getting to Dayton as soon as possible. Between February 1864 and October 1865, the months in which Joshua was mustered into and out of service, his own journey through the Civil War was less eventful than those of the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry and the broader Union Army. Like most African-American Union regiments, the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry worked far from the front lines. In March and April, the 5th Massachusetts, remained at Camp Meigs in preparation. The regiment's officers were scrambling to find horses. The Federal Cavalry Bureau, only a year old, was struggling to meet the high demand for them. The soldiers were also learning to use their new firearms, such as carbines and revolvers, the typical artillery of Union cavalries. Joshua was detailed at the washhouse. At best, he accompanied the troops on trips. On May 5, 1864, he went with the 2nd Battalion on its 2-day journey on the Boston and Providence Railroad toward the District of Columbia. Once there, for 2 months, Company F was stationed aboard steamer Dictator in James River, Virginia. Soon it would advance through the state, onwards to Petersburg, and in mid-June, its very first conflict at Baylor's Farm. When the cavalry was in position to strike, the Confederate Army had retreated and no attack was needed. In the beginning, the men were exposed to a severe crossfire, wrote Charles P. Bowditch, who must have crossed Joshua's path multiple times as the 1st and 2nd Lieutenant and Captain of the 55th Massachusetts Infantry, and again as Captain of the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry. Simultaneous with the crossfire, Bowditch went on, sharpshooters in the woods around made it extremely nasty. Only one of my men was wounded, and not that seriously. If Joshua's battalion lacked military engagement, the men likely witnessed the typical distractions of desertions and training accidents, and the usual horrors of injury, illness, and mortality that befell combat and non-combat soldiers alike. A shortage of horses meant that Joshua and his comrades marched interminably, it seemed. His varicose veins likely continued to encumber, if not debilitate him. From July 1864 to February 1865, Joshua and his fellow soldiers were stationed at Maryland's Point Lookout. The period ended with their guarding Confederate prisoners of war. In March and April, the company sailed on the Red Jacket steamer to Deep Bottom, Virginia, from which it embarked on a number of sites to encamp. Along Charles City Road, the men marched into the outskirts of the city of Richmond, from there into Petersburg, then to Sutherland Station on the South Side Railroad, next to Verina Landing on the James River, then to a camp just 1 mile outside Petersburg. After 1 month of marching to and encamping at Lighthouse Point and City Point in Virginia, Company F boarded the McClellan steamer, sailed a little over 2 weeks, and ultimately landed in Brazos, Santiago, Texas, a small island at the opening of the Rio Grande River. Here they were folded into the Cavalry Brigade of the 25th Army Corps. Morale began to decline in proportion to the incessant fatigue duty and repeated bouts of dysentery, typhus, and scurvy. Many of the white officers in the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry promptly resigned as the regiment withered beneath the scalding Texas sun. On September 28, 1865, the War Department rescued the men by ordering the brigade to be mustered out as soon as possible. On October 31st, the men sailed back home to Massachusetts, landing on Gallup's Island in Boston Harbor. Within a month, they were to be paid and discharged. Joshua happened to make personal strides in this second and final military stint. Secretary of War Edwin Stanton had been slow to promote African-American officers up the ranks. In response to Governor Andrews' inquiry into the matter, Secretary Stanton responded that such stature should not be accorded, except possibly for a few cases of plainly competent persons recommended by the field officers who shall be gentlemen and soldiers of the highest merit and influence. Joshua, according to historian A.W. Drury, was an intelligent man of quiet and dignified bearing. Unlike the other men who served the 5th Massachusetts Cavalry from start to finish, Joshua was promoted to corporal on October 30, 1864, and again to sergeant in May 1, 1865. His military distinction and discipline buoyed the lofty diction he would use to talk to his future wife, children, and acquaintances. Joshua ascended the ranks at a time when the distinction between enlisted men and officers was not only one of military rank, dress, obligations, and compensation. It was also one correlated with racial difference, social segregation, and unequal pay. The commissioned, usually white, officers did not interact much with the African-American soldiers. The discrimination and distrust that had long alienated the races from each other in the outside world bled into the relationship between the officers and the soldiers in the Massachusetts colored regiments. But some of the older enlistees, such as those in their 40s and 50s, displayed the maturity and wisdom to adjust to these conditions and receive promotion. Joshua turned out to be one of those gentlemen, said Stanton. On October 1865, Joshua's Company F of the 55th Massachusetts was mustered out in Texas, his regiment's final place of deployment. Afterward, the regiment returned to Northeastern headquarters, Gallup's Island in Boston Harbor. Joshua was due almost $7 for clothing, $11 for arms and equipment, and $300 in bounty payment. After mustering out of the Union Army in 1865, Joshua returned to Troy, Ohio. Aside from his place of birth and early rearing in Kentucky, Joshua knew Ohio best. Incidentally, his enlistment records listed Troy as his permanent residence, although it remains unclear why. The state was perfect for him. African Americans were flocking there. In the 1860s, its African American population grew by 72%. By 1870, Ohio was second only to Pennsylvania among the northern states in the size of its African American population, and second only to New Jersey in terms of having the largest percentage of African Americans in its total population. Joshua might have been aware that the increasing settlement of African Americans in Ohio led to vocal and conniving efforts by some lawmakers and politicians to stem their influx into the state or to deny their sense of freedom within it. Controversies distinguished the political culture of Ohio. African Americans found encouragement in advocating for better labor opportunities, constitutional franchise, the racial desegregation of public spaces, and higher education. Yet they encountered statutes, the so-called black laws, that discouraged them from settling in the state. They also realized the ambivalence many Democratic and Republican politicians expressed toward enforcing the legal protections African Americans needed to survive there. Joshua returned to Troy. As a civilian once again, he hoped that he could resume the life he left behind. Sometime between February and April 1866, Matilda made the move from Louisville, Kentucky, to the eastern side of Dayton, Ohio, in a section once called the Haymarket area. Dayton was meaningful to African Americans precisely for its geographic accessibility. From the time the first African Americans settled in Dayton in 1798, controversy and transience coexisted. Some residents fled to Haiti by the end of the 1820s. Conflict arose by the early 1840s across the color line in the southwestern part of the newly incorporated city when white mobs burned down the homes of African Americans. In the years before the Civil War, Dayton was a site of permanent disembarkation for slaves who had just crossed the Ohio River. The city also was a detour for slaves on their way to Canada. In any case, Dayton was a place where abolitionists met. Anti-slavery societies formed, and manumitted or fugitive slaves fled, just as they did in adjacent Ohio cities like Piqua and Xenia, in the cities slightly farther away, like Sydney and Troy, as well as the larger cities of Cincinnati and Columbus. Matilda's mother, Elizabeth, owned property in Dayton on 47 Howard Street, as did her grandmother, Rebecca, on 311 Howard Street. Matilda was already 3 to 5 months pregnant with her second child. Her husband, Wilson, had taken up a second stint with the Union Army and had yet to return. Another renter in the Louisville house where Matilda and her son lived happened to work for a steamboat that regularly took passengers from Kentucky across the Ohio River to Ohio. The man was generous with his time and help. Not only did he tend to Matilda's baggage as she tried to corral her son, William, he guided her to the steamboat on which they traveled overnight across the river to Cincinnati, and he helped her secure a train ride from there to Dayton. When Matilda and her son joined her mother and grandmother to live in Dayton, they defied the odds. Slavery notoriously tore families apart, and their inability to reunite became a fact of life in the post-bellum years. Freed women faced the other post-war afflictions, illiteracy and poverty, declining biological fertility, even as they presided over households with 6 or 7 children on average. Cultural obstacles blocking their children who needed to attend school, and the burdens borne both inside and outside the home to maintain even a meager living. Matilda's sense of domestic obligation to take care of her children, of strengthening the bonds of family, was rooted well before the Civil War, albeit under very different conditions. African American women, particularly in the South, were charged to take care of whites, the children, the elderly, the sick, even more during the Civil War than before it. Masters and physicians in wartime were drawn away from their plantations to the battleground. The Union Army, on the other hand, encouraged African American women to convene their own families and abandon the relationships with whites that had been imposed on them, relationships that were asymmetrical in power and hence fragile. The preference by African Americans to work either in the home or in the field, either on their home plantation in the South or somewhere in the North, was bound up with political questions of agency and freedom. Matilda's own desire to travel from Kentucky to Ohio, to reunite with those who had left her behind and awaited her eventual arrival in Dayton, resembled the aspirations of countless other African-American women of her time, to do what was in the best interest of her life and her family, now that bondage as they knew it had ceased. Matilda's reunion with her mother and grandmother was also imperative. She and fellow freedwomen who were single mothers regarded rural life financially untenable. Like most African-American migrants from the South, they sought employment in cities. Life remained stressful for Matilda as she, along with other freedwomen in her situation, moved from slavery, from beneath the thumbs of masters, mistresses, and overseers, to a freedom that put them under the contractual oversight of landlords, which not infrequently replicated slavery's duress. But her decision to work in the domestic sphere was deliberate. Now manumitted or emancipated from bondage, many African-American women embraced the idea that field labor was a job more than worth leaving behind. In the years spent at her mother's house, Matilda knew domestic work best. Work of this kind was not without its problems. Freed women trying to make ends meet while working for white men or women often had to tend to their every need, vulnerable to their whims, almost as if slavery were reborn in post-war form. Freed women regularly complained to the Freedmen's Bureau that their employers refused to pay them what they earned. Despite these problems, many African American women had to accept low-wage work as domestic servants, laundresses, nurses, cooks, if only because they wanted the autonomy to deposit earnings in bank accounts held by the Freedmen's Savings and Trust Bank when it was stable before the Panic of 1873, and to develop greater self-reliance. Servants and laundresses accounted for 70% of African-American women working in cities during the couple of decades after the war. Likely to work long and hard their whole adult lives, African-American women by 1870 were 3 times more likely than white women of leisure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.